huge amounts of space.
I'm in New York City about to interview Dr. Jordan B. Peterson, author of 12 Rules for Life, Antidote for Chaos. I look forward to exploring the power of Christ as an ethic and an aesthetic that can help us unmask the power of collectivism and restore nonviolence and respect for each person, no matter who they are, as the cornerstone of what it means to live in a free and prosperous society. Enjoy.
Looking at on your Twitter, you were in the Netherlands, right?
Yeah, wow. We just flew in last night. Wow. That's right.
Are you all over it in scrambled time? Are you feeling good?
Yeah, well,
your adrenaline kicks in, right? You rise to the occasion.
Yeah,
right?
Well, so far so good.
Great. Well, very good. I'm a writer for the American Conservative and townhall.com and various publications in that wheelhouse, and been following your work, and I've been very impressed with what you've been able to accomplish with your message, defending the person against the collective.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of speaks to where I come from. Are you familiar with René Girard?
Yep.
He's an anthropologist that I derive a lot of my insights when I do my editorials and my interviews, because I think he's a fellow traveler with us. You know, he recently passed away, but his insights have really shaped my understanding of the importance of Christ as a grounding,
symbol
for
absolutely
for
that grounding symbol.
Exactly.
Yeah, you can look at it almost purely psychologically if you want.
Right.
You need a symbol of transcendent good.
Right. I tell people, Christ should be someone we want to imitate, whether we're religious or not.
Right.
He's the greatest man in history.
Well, it's the act of imitation that is the religious element.
Right.
You know, and one of the advantages too of a transcendent ideal is that everyone bows to it, including the king.
Yeah.
Right. And this is something that's really necessary to understand from a psychological perspective, is that if there's no transcendent ideal, then the king is then it's the king.
Right.
Well, that's no good, because the king has to bow down to something too.
Sure.
And then the real question is what should the king bow down to? That's the ultimate question. Right. So and people have worked that out over tens of thousands of years.
And what's great about Jesus, he's the only great man of history who says, imitate me because I'm just an imitator.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just purely an imitator.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every great man, Nietzsche, they're always this sense of, imitate me, just try to catch up.
Mm-hmm.
Just try to catch up, almost like a model obstacle. But with Jesus, he says, you're going to do greater things than me.
Mm-hmm.
That's fascinating to me that, you talk about, how...
That's right. That is something that's absolutely crucial, that particular line.
Which it's a way of patterning your life in a way that doesn't create obstacle and scandal for those around you.
Mm-hmm. And what do you mean by obstacle and scandal?
What I mean by that is he's not saying, try to keep up, bow to me, and maybe he washes your feet.
Right.
He says, you're going to do greater things than
right,
me.
Right.
So when you imitate that ethic, you carry that into your neighborhood relationships,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And suddenly you see that you're imitating a person who's not creating a kind of obstacle to attaining what you see in them.
Right.
Yeah, that's what Girard's always about, is imitation. The idea
right.
that mimetic desire is what governs so much of our desires.
Mm-hmm.
We want what our neighbor has, not because...
Well, see, it's even deeper than want.
Right.
I mean, one of the things about human beings that's very peculiar, there's a lot of things about human beings that are peculiar. Opposable thumb is peculiar. Ability to speak is peculiar. We have incredibly good vision. That's peculiar. But and of course our language function, but I may have mentioned that, but the other thing that's peculiar about us is that we can imitate, which means that I can pattern my body after yours, so I can directly incorporate, and that's the right word, your action patterns into my action patterns. That's actually a prerequisite to language.
Right.
And you hear monkey see, monkey do, but animals aren't imitative, not at all.
Right.
Well, I shouldn't say that.
Far less than us.
Far less. Octopi are imitative, so because they turn out to be very smart, although they don't live very long. So if you give an octopus a crab in a jar with a cork, the octopus will figure out how to pull the cork out and then get in and get the crab. If another octopus watches that octopus, it'll learn it faster.
Right.
So there are animals who can imitate, but we've taken that to an unbelievable degree. And then the issue across time becomes, okay, well, if someone's teaching you to fish, then you imitate knowing how to fish. But if but you want to know more than how to fish. You want to know how to fish. You want to know how to hunt, and you know how to talk, and you want to know how to get along with people. And all of that produces a pattern that's very, very sophisticated. It's what's good across all of those different domains. And that gets abstracted up into something like the symbol. This is the symbol of the self that Jung talked about that was associated with Christ. So, and that's the psychological idea. And it's a brilliant idea.
Yeah.
You're imitating the highest good, whatever that is. And it's something like the willingness to voluntarily sacrifice yourself to the good. It's something like that. I mean, it's much more complicated than that, but that's at least part of it.
Right.
Now, I was talking with a podcast, was it Owen Benjamin this morning, a comedian? And we were talking about this. And then another one after, I think his name was Bunyan. He runs a podcast that is encouraging young men to get the hell up and get at it, you know?
Yeah.
And we were talking about the idea of even hoisting your cross as that. It's like, well, the cross is a place of suffering, voluntary suffering. It's like, well, lift the damn thing up and get on with it. That's the idea.
Yeah. Your book, I think, encapsulates that. 12 Rules for Life, An Antidote to Chaos.
Yeah.
I was remarking to our friend, I said, you know, that word antidote, an earlier word for that might be pharmakos.
Right.
And it brings to mind the Greek ritual of the pharmakos, of the sacrifice of a deformed or a weak person as a way of venting the collective's frustrations by purging an enemy other or someone who's ugly.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought...
Yeah, well, you're supposed to do that to yourself.
Exactly. That's,
yeah. But that's a lot better than doing it to someone else.
Yeah, so my question is, so what happened in history that pivoted the sacrifice of another as the supreme ethic of society to self-sacrifice.
Yeah, yeah.
What was that?
Well, that's a massive psychological transformation. You know, you see that occurring at least in part in the Abrahamic stories. Because, first of all, the sacrifice is external. It's the sacrifice of the son, let's say, or it's the sacrifice of an animal. But the sacrifice eventually becomes something psychological rather than something physical. So people, and I wrote about this a fair bit in 12 Rules for Life, is first of all, people stumbled across the idea that in order to progress into the future towards an ideal, which meant they had to discover the future, and they had to discover an ideal, and they had to discover the notion of progress, very, very difficult things, it was very likely that you would have to give up something that you valued in the present. So there was this is actually the discovery of the future and of human potential. Oh, I can give up something I need now, and something better will happen later. That's the sacrifice. Now you think, no other animals ever figured that out. So there's thousands or ten thousands of years or hundreds of thousands of years trying to puzzle that out. Well, when it's first acted out, it's the sacrifice of something concrete.
Right.
But then it gets symbolized, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And so what do you have to give up to progress forward? How about your weaknesses?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, that's a good thing to give up. That's a fine thing to give up. So when everyone understands what that means, you know, and we wonder when we look back at these Old Testament stories, for example, just what the hell people were thinking when they were sacrificing something on an altar. It's like, why did they believe that would work?
Mm-hmm.
But if you talk to a modern person, I tell my students this all the time, a lot of them are children of first-generation immigrants. I say to them, well, what did your parents sacrifice to get you to university? And it's like, oh, yeah, well, we know that. They sacrificed all sorts of things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They understand the idea of sacrifice immediately. It's like, well, it's a crew. Then the question is, well, if sacrifice is the proper way of life, then what's the right thing to sacrifice? That's question number one.
Right.
And to what end? Well, you sacrifice, the end should be the best end you could imagine. And then the sacrifice should be whatever's necessary to sacrifice to attain that end. A lot of that's worked out symbolically, I would say, in the Christian story. And that it is the working out of that idea. That's
right.
Another way of looking at it.
For me, when I look at the Passion of the Christ, it's something really remarkable happening in history where it appears as if before that, you had the camera of history, so to speak, was being told from the vantage point of the collective. So that, you know, Oedipus in the story, Oedipus admits that he's guilty, that he's the cause of the plagues, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he says, I'm guilty, I did it, you're right, I did all the bad stuff you tell me I am. He blots his eyes out and he casts himself out. So it's like the winning crowd writes the story so that the victim is proclaimed to be guilty from his own mouth.
Mm-hmm.
But with Jesus, it's the first time in history where the same dying and rising myth is told, but now it's in a gritty, realistic fashion in which the gods are not demanding it, but rather it's just a petty crowd. And it's now told from the vantage point of the victim. It's like the camera goes from the crowd to the victim, and now you see it from a different perspective.
More
and,
the sufferer than the victim.
Okay.
Right? Well, I mean, because it isn't obvious that Christ conceives of himself as a victim. He's definitely the sufferer,
right?
And he's someone who's doing this voluntarily. But I should have interrupted, but I get your point.
Right, so that's what I'm trying to get at. Is I think that was the crux where we pivoted in history, which allowed for the person to have dignity against the collective, which is once you have the crowd, now we see the crowd as just the demanding the murder of an innocent victim. And yeah, he doesn't claim to be a victim, but he's a victim of the lynch mob.
Yes, right? Definitely.
And so
he's set up to be a victim. There's no doubt about that.
And so that's the first time, because every other time before that, it's almost like the victims are always, the scapegoats are always admitting that they're guilty of the crime.
Mm-hmm.
And they're almost mythologized into the sky as gods. So that's what Girard gets into, the idea that yesterday's gods were actually at one point victims themselves. So Zeus is a stand-in for ritual human sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the thing I'm trying to get into, because I think that's the heart of what you're battling right now. With the outrage mobs, and you're trying to say, wait a second, protect the person, protect the person. Don't pinpoint it on a collective group. It's the white males, or it's this group, or it's that group, or it's this group. Stop the revenge game, right?
Well, especially
when, the human person, no matter who they are.
Especially when the revenge game has nothing to do with the perpetrators. That's the problem with group identity. It's like you're not punishing the perpetrators of the actual crime. I mean, you can assume, with some reason, that history is the story of endless criminal behavior. It's like, it's not only that, and that's important to note, but it's definitely that. I mean, history is a bloody madhouse. Well, whose feet do you lay that at? Well, you lay it at people's feet by racial identity? That's a really bad idea. There's nothing in that that's going to produce anything good. And I don't think anything good is aimed at by it, fundamentally. I think it's a desire for more mayhem. It's a desire for revenge against something that you can't even take revenge for. Right. Now, it's like, okay, your place in history is insufficient, right? Because history is tragic. Your own personal life is tragic. And you are the victim. God, I hate that word. You are you are subject to the tyranny of the state.
Right.
Well, and is the state without blood on its hands? Well, obviously not. Okay, well, so you're subject to a tyrant with blood on its hands. Well, that's an unfortunate situation to be in. Well, what do you look for? Revenge? Well, against who? The state's dead. All the people who produced it's dead. Well, that's the thing. Never. It never stops.
So you were talking about reciprocity in your book, and I was thinking, that's a really key issue. Are we going to sow good reciprocity or bad reciprocity?
Right,
kind of the key issue. Are you going to stop the chain of violence, the cycle, vendettas? That's how it was in the old, you kill my brother, I kill your whole village.
Yep.
You want to wipe out my whole generation.
Right.
And it never ends. Until, again, going back to what René Girard has showed me, is that until you find a single victim or a class that you say, this is the penultimate witch, burn them, eat them, whatever it takes, you devour them, you consume them, and then you've kind of appeased the crowd. Because when everybody's in a sea of sameness, right, everybody's pointing fingers. No, you're to blame. No, you're to blame. No, you stole from my hut. No, you stole from my hut. Everybody's in a sea of resentment. It's good to find something that stands out in a sea of sameness. That's an easy target.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what was happening, when I first saw the issue with the university, with the transgender laws, the speech laws.
Yeah, okay. So I see more what you mean. I mean, what happened with the Channel 4 interview in London is a good example of that, because the Kathy Newman, who interviewed me, really didn't interview me. She interviewed who she thought I was, and the person she was interviewing, who she thought I was guilty patriarchal perpetrator.
Right.
And I kept saying, well, yeah, fair enough, but that's not me. That's not what I'm saying. I mean, I don't buy the whole guilty patriarchal perpetrator to begin with, but assuming such a creature exists, it's not me. And we don't need to have that conversation.
We're not far removed from the Minotaur, where you otherize the monster. You take away their humanity. So you're no longer just a human being in good faith. Now you're a stand-in for an ideological monster.
Okay, so that helped me understand Girard more. I see more what he was aiming at with regards to the idea of that necessary sacrifice. So yeah, well.
So do we do we put our skin in the game? Do we self-offer, or do we sacrifice another?
Well, that's the question.
That's the big issue.
Yeah, that is the big. Well, and that's the big issue. Period. I think. I mean, if you're thinking about the moral lesson of the story of the Passion, the lesson is sacrifice yourself to defeat evil. It's something like that. And then you might. Then the question might be, well,
because evil resides ultimately in us, right?
Yeah. Well, the evil you can control does, anyways, to the degree that you can control it. That's right. You might as well start there, because otherwise you end up as a perpetrator.
You know the Leviticus story about the scapegoat. You know where they would cast their hands onto the little smelly he goat with his tongue sticking out.
Yep.
In Leviticus.
Yep.
And they would all put their sins on the back of right. this little sneaky goat.
Yep.
And send them off into the wilderness.
Right.
And to me, when I saw the video of you surrounded by the activists yelling, shame, 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 going crazy,
yeah.
I pictured one of those scapegoats from Leviticus mm-hmm. wandering back into the town once they thought they had taken care of it and sent it off the cliff. And it's coming back with arrows and it's got its ear. And they're like, what are you doing in our sacred space? You're violating our mm-hmm. space because mm-hmm. you, being a thought crime, a speech crime violator, you are representative as a professor of a voice of people that are supposed to be cast outside the mm-hmm. camp mm-hmm. to preserve the purity.
Yeah, well, it was
so that's
another,
what was going on. You were a scapegoat walking
it was
in.
Another example of that demonization. So you imagine that the radical activist types have this figment in their imagination of the patriarchal oppressor, whoever that happens to be, and that's really a figure of Satan in some sense, right? It's more like the statist symbol of Satan. And then the issue is, who do you put that upon? And they test it. It's like, well, maybe it's you. Maybe it's you. Maybe it's you. It's like, well, my sense was, no, sorry. First of all, I'm not sure that exists the way that you think it does. And if it does, it's not me. Because that isn't what I'm doing. So, and all of this, in some sense, has been a test about that. And I think that culminated in this interview with Kathy Newman, where she really... Well, it was a kind of a miracle of interviews in some sense, because what the person she was interacting with bore so little resemblance to me that it was painfully obvious to the people that were watching the interview. And it really has to be obvious before that becomes obvious, right? Because often, I mean, if I'm watching two people talk and I don't know either of them, if one is confused about the other, how the hell am I going to know? Because I don't know. I can't tell. But in that interview, it's so strange. She made it obvious over and over and over. And I'm not exactly sure why. I don't understand that, because you'd think
you were speaking heresy.
And yeah, but
her
you
job
think,
was to she's sure. the Grand Inquisitor. She's sure, making but, sure that she but, had done her job to make you look bad.
She did. That's it. But you'd think that, look, when you do something so evidently that 3 million people notice, you know, like everyone sees it, you have to wonder why you didn't see it when you were doing it. You know what I mean?
She's like, possessed by the crowd, by the spirit of the time. It's not her particularly. We're all possessed by group things. She's no different. But
it was so obvious. That's the thing. It's often that subtle. And it's almost as if when it becomes obvious like that, when it becomes made so obvious, maybe it's almost done with. Maybe. I doubt it, but you never know.
But I mean, if she had just treated you as this is a dignified perspective that we should really take into consideration, how would her bosses think about that?
Well, this is the other thing we don't know. Like, I don't know Channel 4 that well. I don't know her journalistic background. I don't know her personal background. I don't know what she was up to in that interview. You know, when I first went in there, I sat for about 3 or 4 minutes with her before the camera started to roll, and she was quite personable, you know, like professional, and like a news, like an anchor person is. They're very professionalized, you know. They have a persona. They're all made up, and they look better than they are. That's what a news anchor looks like. But she was very polite and engaging, and we had a fine little conversation. But as soon as the cameras went on, it was like she transformed into 20 miniature attack pit bulls. And was just all over me, you know. And I thought, I noticed right away what was going on. And I thought, well, this is peculiar. What the hell is this? What's driving this? And I thought, well, is this her journalistic style? Has she made her career this way? is this what Channel 4 expects from their newscasters? Is this the state of modern British journalism? Is she just playing devil's advocate, which you have to be careful about because you can turn into the devil himself? Was she trying to score points on me? Was it a primate dominance game, which I write about in 12 Rules for Life in Chapter 9, which is called Assume That the Person That You're Listening To Knows Something You Don't. And one of the kind of conversations I describe in there is the primate dominance hierarchy conversation. And then afterwards, when all this emerged, I thought, okay, how is she responding to this? It's like about 100,000 people have commented on the YouTube video. And almost all the comments are seriously negative. It's like, do you write that all off as trolls? Or do you... Because I know what would happen if I did an interview and 3 million people watched it and 100,000 people told me that what I did was inexcusable. I don't know if I'd ever recover from that. Like, I would take that to heart, man. It would, right. It would do me in. And so I don't understand how is she reacting to that? Is she just saying, oh, it's all like right-wing trolls, which it most certainly is not.
Well, she becomes kind of a martyr figure, right?
Well, that was really interesting too, because the interview completed. I was very busy. I went off to the next interview, but I thought, oh, well, that was, shook my head. That was interesting. I thought they'd edit it down and just not give the accurate representation of what happened, but right. They didn't, yeah. Which is also something really interesting. They put the whole thing online. It's like, I was shocked at that. And then everybody jumped on that. It was trending on YouTube like mad. And the was overwhelmingly critical of Kathy. And I thought, well, that's really interesting. And then 2 days later, The Guardian wrote a newspaper article and said that she was being victimized, right, by all this criticism. And they said, well, we had to bring in a security specialist and, you know, we got the police involved. And I thought, well, the way they wrote the article was, they didn't say, Kathy Newman is in danger, here's the proof. They said, Jordan Peterson is a horrible alt-right, you know, far-right, you know, cult leader with hordes of minions who are attacking this innocent journalist, and there's been threats. It's like, oh, I see. The threats are just the excuse to, you know, to continue this assault on my character and this ideological war. And then, so I thought that was really reprehensible, and I do believe it was. But then, like, 20 newspapers picked up that narrative. It was all, oh my God, Kathy Newman is, like, victim of the week. And that really shocked me, because that was such an inversion of the reality. And so I was really upset about that. I guess it was yesterday morning, the day before, how that had been twisted. And then I'd tweeted, I said, because I read the victim thing and I thought, yeah, well, probably not, but there's probably some idiots out there who are going farther than they should. So I tweeted and I said, look, you know, if you're threatening, back off, because we had a conversation. Like, you might not like how it went, and maybe I didn't either. It's not the point. You don't threaten her. That's too far. So back off. But there was a little part in the back of my mind that said, well, you know, maybe you shouldn't have said that, because there was no credible evidence of threats. And then what happened was all these newspapers that were spinning it to making her into the victim. And it was like 15 UK newspapers did that, and probably 5 Canadian newspapers. It was shocking. They used the fact that I tweeted in her defense as proof that she was being threatened. And I thought, oh my God, now here I've gone out and said, you know, like a reasonable person would say, back off, hounds, like, don't go too far. And then instead of accepting that, let's say, gracefully, they just used it to spin the narrative. But then...
But see, they smelled that as like a close to...
Apology, I know.
Right?
I know. That's right. Well, that's it. And one of the things I've learned in the last 15 months, and this is my advice to anybody who gets tangled up in this sort of thing, is like, first of all, be careful what you say. Like, don't be incautious. But if you believe what you said, do not apologize. Because you cannot apologize to a mob. You can apologize to a person. You cannot apologize to a mob. It's an admission of guilt and a sign of weakness. And so, yeah, I would say I skirted apology there. And now, I'm not sure it was a mistake, because people also responded positively to the fact that I said, like, leave her alone, you know. But it was misused, which I found. And that's really something, eh? When the situation is set up so that a genuinely positive impulse and a genuinely positive act is punished, then you know that pathological things are happening. But then things flipped around again, and a whole bunch of people wrote a counter narrative saying, look, you know, it's reprehensible that Kathy Newman is being portrayed as a victim. That happened in The Atlantic yesterday. Wrote a big article about that. And that was number one on their site. And now today the Times in London wrote an article.
Changing.
Well, yeah, it's so, I mean, I think that, yeah, because the leftist narrative, the victim narrative was all the people who are responding badly to Kathy are right-wing trolls who are vicious and misogynistic and who don't realize that the poor woman was just doing her job. And there's so many elements of untruth in that. It's like, they're not all alt-right trolls. There's way too many of them. And most of the comments, although critical, are reasonable. She wasn't a victim who was just, first of all, she's not a victim. She's a high-paid news broadcaster and she has plenty of power. She's no damn victim. And you know, it's not obvious that she's, what would you call it, an oppressed female victim of the patriarchy or like a major player in the patriarchy. I would put her in the latter category. So, and anyways, that was the narrative, but it online, that didn't fly at all, right? People were just saying, well, they were saying what I thought was obvious is like my sense when I watched the video, and I felt this when I was in the studio, and I think this is part of my clinical expertise kicking in. I thought, she didn't say a damn thing in that entire interview that she actually believed to be true, except when she was rendered speechless for a second or two. And then one of my friends, because I said, she backtracked, and I said, ha, gotcha. And it was a satirical comment. Like, I wasn't trying to, you know, ram the knife home. I was trying to play it light a bit, you know, and to say something funny. One of my friends, who's a very wise person, said, you know, you could have, instead of doing that, you could have taken that opportunity to say, okay, look, now we finally agreed on something. You know what I mean. You know, that's why you were taken aback. You actually understand what I mean. Now we could have a real conversation. Yeah. But
hindsight's 20/20.
Well, you know, that would have been a different way of playing it. We were almost out of time at that point in the interview anyways. But I have wondered if, I mean, there's nothing wrong with humor. It's really, really useful. But maybe it would have been a better time to have offered a hand, you know. And then I contacted her through some channels and said, look, you know, here's how this should end. It shouldn't end with me winning because I don't regard this as a victory because the conversation didn't go well and that would have been a victory, right? And this isn't me against you and I win and you lose because I'm not interested in that. I don't think that's the right outcome. I said, what should happen now is that we had this, let's get together and have a real conversation, like see if we can get past the invective and ideological idiocy and devil's advocacy and primate dominance hierarchy maneuvering and all of that and have a conversation. And she wrote back and she said, well, I need to think about it for a few days, but I don't understand what all the fuss is about. I thought the interview went very well. And I thought, oh, it just sort of left me speechless. It's like, fair enough, you want to take a break from this. I understand that. It's got to be fairly intense. You know, although I also don't know, is she happy about it? Is Channel 4 happy about the fact that, you know, like 3 million people have watched it in 3 days? It's a hit. If you're running a tabloid, you want views.
It was good business.
They got the views, mm-hmm. You know, and maybe only 40% of them thinks that way or something, but I have no idea what the underground motives are.
My kind of crux of what I see with what's happening here is that we're facing the 2,000 years of being infected with the Christian story. And we've, so far at this point in our Western experience, we're starting to question, of course, the metaphysics as outdated and passé.
Mm-hmm.
But the ethic and the underlying aesthetic of supreme, divinity being on the side of the naked, abandoned, wrongfully accused, murdered and tortured innocent man outside mm-hmm. the camp, not in the inner sanctum of our clique, but on the farthest reaches, right? That aesthetic has a way of undermining, like the Bible says, that the kingdom of heaven is like a yeast working itself slowly in a loaf.
Right.
And so it doesn't work perfectly. Of course, there's fits and starts, and the church, of course, has sacrificially gone in with imperial powers and mm-hmm. gone through the witch trials and
yep.
things like that
yep.
too. So
yep.
we're
yep.
wrestling out our species is working out our salvation with fear and trembling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well,
it's quite, you're in the middle of that.
It's quite a metaphor, that metaphor of the yeast in the bread, for exactly that reason. And you can see that working itself out with regards to the idea of slavery in the U.S. It's like that was backsliding, essentially, as the English realized, which is why they made slavery illegal very, very rapidly. It was backsliding. The ethic that was driving the development of the West was an anti-slavery ethic. And that triumphed, that prevailed over narrow economic interests, I would say, at the cost of at least one war, but it did prevail. And the same thing happened with regards to the emancipation of the serfs. And then the same thing happened with regards to the emancipation of women. It's like these ideas have their life, and they are playing themselves out across time, and hopefully, and they're emerging victorious, I would say. Now, you know, we've been in danger of throwing the baby out with the bathwater, probably, well, Nietzsche got it about right, you know, announcing the death of God back in the late 1800s. But it is definitely time to look back and think, okay, well, what did we get right? And we certainly got the ethic of individuality right. That's a big deal. Now, I think we got the ethic of private property right, too. And I talked with Ben Shapiro a little bit about that. And, you know, we were talking about he talked about, I think it was John Locke's idea that, well, you have a right to private property, like a bird has a right to its nest or a wolf has a right to its den. But what allows that right to remain tenable is the fact that you take responsibility for the property and you tend it like a garden so that it also produces for everyone else. And so that it's not only in your best interest to have the property, but it's in everyone else's interests too. And I don't think that that's an unattainable ideal. I think that's actually how it works. You know, you want the most competent person in charge of the territory, whatever it happens to be.
Right.
And if they're really good at what they do, they not only produce what they need, but they overproduce so that there's plenty for everyone.
Right.
And we're also in a situation where if we were careful, there could easily within 10 years, we could have plenty for everyone. It's happening already. Like, there's no starvation in the world anymore, except in Venezuela. You know, there's no starvation except where there are political reasons for it. And so we could emerge in the next, and the economic revolution that's occurred in the last 30 years with regards to bringing people out of absolute privation has occurred at a rate that's never occurred in the entire course of human history.
Mm-hmm.
So we could find ourselves in a situation where there was more than enough for everyone. It's like, wow, well, that would really be something.
Well, Girard says it well. Girard says, you know, we didn't discover the scientific method. Well, he says, we didn't stop burning witches because we discovered the scientific method. We discovered the scientific method because we stopped burning witches.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
mm-hmm.
like after we lose that spell of the crowd mind saying, this is the way we will solve our social crises. This is the way we're going to resolve the war of all against all by blaming this person, the Jew, for the plague or the witch for the spell that's caught everybody into a frenzy.
Mm-hmm.
That catharsis starts to lose its power, and no longer are we united by the ritual human sacrifice of an enemy other.
Mm-hmm.
And now
need something else to unite us.
Right. And that's what we're wrestling through together. And you're in the mm-hmm. middle of this maelstrom, which is
mm-hmm.
fascinating with this book.
Well, maybe we could unite ourselves in recognition of the enemy within.
Right.
That would be a good thing.
The crucifixion of the self,
mm-hmm.
right? The mortification mm-hmm. of the flesh.
Well, one of the things that I talked about in Rule 7 was the idea that there's this idea, that Christian idea, that the Messiah is the person who takes the sins of the world onto himself. And I thought about that for a long time. It's like, because these ideas have psychological realities. Like, well, what does that mean? Well, it means, and I've seen this play out in my clinical practice when this has been very practical injunction, to take the world, to take the sins of the world unto yourself is to read history as a perpetrator and not as a victim. And that's unbelievably useful for two reasons. First of all, it's like, it's the case. It is the history of atrocity is the history of this human psyche as perpetrator. And you're human. So like, clue in, it's about you. And so, and that's the terrible side of it. That's almost unbearable, that. And that's why people don't do it, because who the hell wants to envision themselves as the perpetrator of history's crimes? But then there's a perverse reversal that goes along with that, which is that, well, if you're the monster that did those terrible things, you might also be the monster that could set it right. It's like, oh, and you wouldn't realize that to begin with, because you wouldn't have enough. And it's kind of like respect for yourself. You don't take yourself seriously enough until you know that how bad you could become. So, and that's also something I learned from reading Jung, because Jung was, of course, you know, his basic idea was that it was necessary for psychological development to encounter the shadow, the dark part of yourself, and
right.
and that the shadow reached all the way down to hell. And he really, he meant that. He meant that as literally as you could mean it.
Remember the story of Jesus with the Gerasenes? He goes to this town where they have the demoniac, and he says his name is Legion. Mm-hmm. That's an interesting little piece
it is,
there, right?
It is.
Because he's saying, my name is the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
My name is the Roman soldiers, Legion, that to
that's
bind
right,
together.
That's the crowd, yeah.
So my name is the very act of binding together.
Mm-hmm.
It's like he's necessary for the function of the town to function. Mm-hmm. It's like he's over there self-stoning himself, right? And he's over there wailing and crying in the tombs while the town functions in its relative normalcy in contrast to him, right? So when Jesus heals him of this illness, it's very interesting because the text says the town was terrified.
Mm-hmm.
They needed him as an enemy other. They needed him to be a benchmark by which they could define their unity together. And when they lost it, they lost everything that made them who they were.
Yeah, well, one of the unanswered questions about how human beings can unite themselves is if it's possible for us to do that in the absence of an identifiable external enemy. But I do think the idea that you could unite yourself with the realization of an identifiable internal enemy is a good one. I mean, I figured out, and I wrote about this a fair bit in 12 Rules for Life. One of the things I've been puzzling out for the last 30 years is I kind of came to understand what it meant for there to be a serpent in the garden. And that meant that you can't make a bounded space and keep everything out. It's not possible. What you try to keep out comes in. And that's something like the tension between the finite and the infinite. Like, for example, this is one of the points I made in the book, is imagine that you decide that you're going to protect your children from all the evil in the world. And so you keep them in the basement and you shelter them from everything. Well, then you become the evil in the world, because you're the overprotective parent who won't let your children thrive.
The great mother.
Yeah, exactly. The Oedipal mother. There's no way around it. So you can't do that. You cannot build a space so safe that no evil can emerge from within it, or no chaos. Chaos, evil. So then the question is, well, what do you do as an antidote to that? And the issue is there that you... the serpent is in the Garden of Eden is the fact that you can't make a bounded space and get rid of all the complexity of the world. It's going to pop up inside in one form or another. But then there's this strange idea that developed across time that the serpent in the Garden of Eden is Satan. And you think, what? What the hell does that mean? Because that certainly was not part of the original story, that idea. Although it might have been there in a latent form, like the yeast we were talking about. But the idea is that it's something like the serpent in the garden is the snake, and then it's the place of all possible snakes, and then it's the snake that's in your neighbor's heart, right? So that starts to become symbolic. But then finally, it's the snake that's in your own heart. And then you have an association between the serpent and the spirit of evil. It's something like that. So the idea is, it's so brilliant. The ultimate serpent in the garden is the spirit of evil. It's like, yes, that's exactly right. And it's all laid out symbolically. I mean, it's a realization of incomparable artistic grandeur. Nobody could formulate it in words, but that's the basic idea. The ultimate snake is the spirit of evil. It's like, yes, that's exactly right. So then you confront that within you. You confront that within yourself. That's the right way to go about it. And that just seems to be correct to me.
And the snake is also inviting you to try to devour infinite being in the created order rather than in the transcendent.
How do you mean?
Because he's saying, you know, if you eat this fruit, God's trying to deprive you, as if they didn't have enough with what God had provided for them already.
Mm-hmm.
It's not enough. You have a barrier between where God's holding back.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was something.
A bad
it's
boss.
So funny because there yeah. was something. And the Christianity itself is very ambivalent about that, right? Because the Gnostics believed that the original God who didn't allow human beings to be self-conscious was evil, and that the serpent was the liberating force, right? And the serpent's often read as the liberating force for a variety of reasons. But the classic Christian take isn't that at all. But it's also ambivalent because the Christian take is, well, there was original sin, and that's what got history moving, essentially. the emergence of self-consciousness, which is a perfectly reasonable way of looking at it, the emergence of self-consciousness was what, and the knowledge of death was what got history moving, because we started to make history to protect ourselves against death, and that was a catastrophe. But it was a fortunate catastrophe, because without it, there would have been no reason for the emergence of Christ. It's like, well, so then is that a bad thing or a good thing? Well, I would say in some sense that's the ultimate question. But it's not self-evident that it's a bad thing. And it makes the initial conundrum that much more mysterious. Mm-hmm. So was it all part of God's mysterious plan to allow people to become self-conscious? Because becoming self-conscious, falling, and then transcending that was better than just staying unself-conscious to begin with. It's like, well, I would say maybe we're playing that out and trying to find out. We're trying to figure that out. Right. Is there a manner in which self-conscious being can be preferable to unconscious being?
Right.
Well, maybe the answer is it depends on how you live it. That's the Christian answer anyways.
Yeah. But what's happening right now, though, with the, you know, I see the politically correct left and just statism in general as being kind of a super Christianity, trying to out-Christianity Christianity. So it's almost as if, hurry up, let's radicalize and let's try to put some teeth to the promises that every human being is made in the image of God.
Mm-hmm.
And let's radicalize that with a little bit of revenge. Let's get back at all the people in groups that have benefited in some sense because of the trajectory of Western history. And so so it's almost like a revenge of the nerds Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Let's get the cool kids.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because it's not enough just to say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Mm-hmm.
That's the one thing we don't want to listen to, right? Jesus is giving us an anthropological fact there. He's not saying a good sentiment. When he's on the cross and he's being crucified, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's a fact.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know what we're doing when we're persecuting our enemies, because we need them to have our transcendence with our identity of our group. That's the problem. But it's failing. That's why we're in such a wonderful point in history, because everything's like apocalyptic here. There's this unveiling taking place. I mean, look at the flag. You know, the flag at least used to unite us. It doesn't unite us anymore. That is a symbol of the unity of, you know, the flag represents what? When you ask somebody, you know, like, what is the sacredness of the flag? It's tied to the blood sacrifice of the soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
And that used to be the thing that bound us together, even in the modern world. But now that's going away. So we're in this place where it's like the training wheels of history, we're losing them.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got to sink or swim.
That's right. Well, we better lose them, because we're producing all sorts of things that we need to be able to master, or they will bring us down.
That's
so the
Saint
training
Paul,
wheels need to come off.
That's what St. Paul is talking about with, baby food, you know. You guys are being fed baby food with your idols.
Mm-hmm.
It's time to give you some meat.
Mm-hmm.
And meat is, you got to let go of your little sacrificial boundaries that you create your little, you know, unity based on. But that's what, you know, that's why we have, you know, so in the old days, you had the myths, you had the divine right of kings, you had these institutional religious beliefs that it is just so that Saturn demands a sacrifice,
mm-hmm,
for Saturnalia, you know. But now it's speech codes, right? It's ideology. And that's what gets you, you know, like what you've experienced, where if you say the wrong words, now you're unveiling the violence.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's always taboos, right? Societies always have taboos. We just shifted around where they are.
Right.
So, yeah.
That's what, you know, when you think about, you know, politically correct speech, it's a way of making speech violence, but violence becomes passé.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's also a way of justifying it. If speech becomes violence, then there's no reason not to use violence to stop it.
Right.
Because they're equated. And I mean, that seems to me to be part and parcel of the postmodernist claim that there's nothing but power. So, which is a really pathological claim. That's another thing I figured out over the last couple of years, partly as a consequence of discussions I've had with Daniel Higgins, who's a student of mine at Harvard, but we've been business partners for years. And one of the things he cautioned me against about a year and a half ago really made me angry when he first brought it up. He said that he told me that I should stop using the dominance hierarchy terminology, because he didn't believe that Western hierarchies were dominance hierarchies. He said he thought that was a kind of a latent Marxism that had crept into psychology/anthropology and biology. maybe animal hierarchies are power hierarchies because they're based often on conflict, although it's not even that obvious, because with wolf packs and with rat societies and with chimpanzees as well, pure naked power doesn't provide a very good basis for long-term status. You get taken out if it's just power. It's a bit more complicated than that, but that'll do. But I started thinking, well, maybe what we have in the West instead are something more like competence hierarchies, where you rise to the top of a hierarchy because you're good at doing things rather than because you're expressing naked power. And that's also something that's very useful to conceptualize, and something that flies in the face of the Marxist analysis of history, which is, again, just that, you know, the way you climb, all your privilege is a consequence of the exercise of tyranny, essentially.
Well, that's another hallmark of Christianity, right? That introduces the idea that you can move up and down the hierarchy. Mm-hmm. If you're in the ancient world, you were stuck in your place.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Except for before, like if you had like a festival, right, where you would they would do like role play games, where the master would change the position,
right,
with the slave, and it was like, this is a temporary, recreated chaos that leads to the culmination of with sacrifice.
Yes,
whether human or animal.
Well, the idea that you should worship the dying and resurrecting God is psychologically equivalent to the idea of individual transformation. You can be something other than you are, and that's a prerequisite or an accompaniment of the idea that you can move up and down dominant or competence hierarchies. Because if you're the same all the time and it's just you, then there's no transformation, right? And there's no difference between transformation and movement in a hierarchy. They're the same thing, essentially. But once you have incorporated the idea that the old you can die and the new you can be reborn, then you can move around pretty much, I wouldn't say infinitely, but this, you have a very wide range of options.
Right. Well, that's the whole, if you have a principle, like Jesus says, God desires mercy, not sacrifice, you're putting a monkey wrench that's going to upend the whole mechanism of preserving that hierarchy. If you were born in a certain caste in the ancient world, you didn't get to go up and jump, follow the American dream. You were stuck there, and you better watch out and make sure you don't try to climb up above yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they you know, preserve differentiation and boundaries.
Well, it was
ultimately founded on a lie.
Well, it's also the standard routine. It's the standard routine among animals. I mean, animal societies don't transform across time to any great degree. And among primates, for example, position in the hierarchy is very heritable. The animals do move to some degree, but not much.
Right.
So this status in primates is often multi-generational.
Right.
So, but that's not any different than saying the societies don't change,
right?
Right? And most of the time societies don't change, and most of the time that's good because they work. So, but that isn't how human societies work. We've decided that transformation is the proper route.
Do you think that one of the things that we really need to nail down in what you're saying with your message and the way you've engaged your opponents coming at you is that we need to rethink what is the nature of law from an ethical standpoint? Because, you know, I was looking at that law and it was, I guess, backed by the threat of violence, right? You could be imprisoned if you don't use the right.
Well, there's a debate about how far it would go, but and different people with different legal opinions have come up with different conclusions.
Right.
But if I failed to use the pronouns, say, when called upon, and I was hauled in front of the Ontario Human Rights Commission, or if I violated the provisions of the Ontario Human Rights Commission, was hauled in front of their social justice tribunal, and I was found guilty, and I was required to take my retraining or pay restitution, and I didn't, then it would be contempt of court, then it would go to the normal court system, and then, well, then it's the ultimate conclusion of that is imprisonment if it goes all the way to the end. Now, people said, well, it would never go that far. It's like, well, yes, it would if someone pushed it. And so I think that the idea that the threat of behind all the law is the threat of imprisonment.
Right.
That's what the law is.
Right.
It's fundamentally, it's the threat of imprisonment. And you could say, well, no, it's just a fine. That's what the people who were setting themselves in opposition to what I was saying said. Well, no, you'll just be fined. It's like,
steal some money from you first.
Well, right. It's like, oh, that's okay. It's just a fine. It's like, that's not okay anyways.
Right.
But, well, what if I don't pay the fine?
Right.
Well, they think, well, that's a different crime. It's like, okay, have it your way. But, you know, that's you're just playing with words at that point.
From a Christian standpoint, to me, I think this is an opportunity for Christians to kind of regain some mojo here in the cultural atmosphere in terms of putting some teeth to the words of Christ in a way that's not violent, in a way that respects the spirit. And what I mean by that is Jesus says, do not resist evil with violence.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I think about that, if I want to be an imitator of Jesus, if I call myself a Christian, that means I want to be a little Jesus or a follower of Jesus, right? If I'm going to be an imitator of Jesus, can I hire people, you know, by voting or going on a jury duty and, you know, saying guilty, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Do I have the moral, ethical right to use violence against my neighbor?
Well, I thought a lot about that line this year because people have been attacking me, eh? And so the question is, well, what do you do when you're attacked? So I'll tell you a couple of stories. So the first thing is, well, I already told you one thing, which was be careful what you say and then don't apologize to the mob because you're done if you do. Okay, so I figured that out. So I've been very careful in what I've been saying and I haven't apologized to the mob. So then I've been observing what happened. So the first thing that happened to me of any significance was that there was a rally, a free speech rally, that I was invited to speak at, and it was disrupted by activists who purported to be merely trying to further the rights of an oppressed minority. I went out after the rally was over, about 2 hours later, to speak to the police to see if everything was okay. And on my way back into the university, I got surrounded by a little mob of social justice activists and also some people who had come out in support of me. And they filmed it. And they asked me a bunch of questions like about the Nazis at my rally, which is an outright lie, and did everything they could to make me look bad. And then they put it on YouTube and they thought, that's the end of that, professor. But that isn't what happened. What happened was that's the most watched video in this entire sequence of events, although this one with Kathy Newman is going to top it soon, but it got about 3.5 million views. But 98%, it's actually higher than that, 98% of the people who watched the video supported me. So that didn't work. That just inverted. Hey? And that I didn't engage in any violent way or even defend myself particularly violently, like I defended myself, but no more than absolutely necessary. I was trying to be reasonable.
To reciprocate aggression.
That's right. I tried not to reciprocate the aggression. And then something else happened at McMaster University. So I was there to give a talk, and a bunch of activists came, and they were pushing their luck. There were two of them behind me, and one of them was just kind of lost and deluded. I could just tell by looking at her. But the guy she was with, he was not a good guy. And I've seen guys like that at some of these rallies. Like, I can tell by looking at them. They make my blood turn cold.
Sneaky.
Well, and perfectly willing to use underhanded violence. Like, they're there for the mayhem. That's why they're there. And I've seen about half a dozen of them, and he was one of them. But they were blaring an air horn at me, and they were doing it close enough to cause damage. Mm-hmm. And they knew it. And so I turned to them. I said, look, like, you can blow your damn air horn, but not 3 feet away from me. And if you keep it up, I'll have the police, because you're not, like, I'm not going deaf. Thank you very much. So, but apart from that, I just let the thing play out and I stayed calm. But I'd also learned by that point, like, just because this looks bad doesn't mean it's bad for me, for what's going on. It looks terrible, but that doesn't mean it is terrible. So that was all videotaped, and that worked tremendously in my favor.
That's the power of media to reverse the mob's power against itself. Mm-hmm. See, that's like Aikido. The camera was your pin that was mightier than their sword.
Mm-hmm. So I've been thinking about this idea of resist, not evil. And so then I had this interview with Kathy Newman, and she was all over me, you know. And I didn't want to... I would say there were two maxims that I was trying to guide myself by, to the degree that I was doing it consciously. Like, some of it was automatic in some sense, but one was resist not evil, and it means something like, it's something, at least part of it is, don't use any more force than is absolutely necessary. Minimum possible force, which is a great English common law maxim as well when you're defending yourself. Minimal possible force, that's a good one. And the other one was, now I've got to remember what it was here. Oh, well, we'll come back to it. I've got most of the story there. But yeah. the Well, all right. Part of it is this, and this is something else that I outline in 12 Rules for Life. I was also, Kathy was trying to accomplish something with the interview. I don't know what it was. It might have been five different things. Status was certainly one of them. Victory was another. Victory for her ideological position was another. There was a bunch of things. Ratings, God only knows. Like, there's a whole bunch of things. I wasn't really trying to accomplish anything with the interview. I was trying to say what I thought. Okay, and so one of the things I realized about the idea of truth, which I do outline in 12 Rules for Life, is that the call to adventure that God presents to Abraham is, in its deepest sense, a call to tell the truth. Because the truth is an adventure, and here's why. It's like you can craft your words to get what you want. The problem is you don't know what you want. You don't in any final sense. But there's an alternative. The alternative is just say what you think to be true and see what happens. And so you could say there's a proclamation of faith underneath that. And I understood this a lot more when I did my biblical lectures last year and I was analyzing the first chapter of Genesis, because what happens in Genesis is God employs the logos to call forth order from potential, from chaos. And when he does so, he says that it's good. So there's an idea there. And the idea is that the thing that confronts potential is the logos, and that's truthful speech. And it's truthful speech that engenders order from the chaos. And if it's truthful speech that engenders order from the chaos, then the order is good. It's a hypothesis. So you think, oh, that's an interesting hypothesis. So here's the hypothesis of faith, and maybe this is the fundamental hypothesis of Christian faith. The order you call forth from potential with truth is good, period. And so I can go into the interview and I can think, well, I'm just going to say what I have to say. I don't care about the consequences. It's not that I don't care. It's that I do care. But I care that the consequences are only those that are associated with what I believe, with saying what I believe to be true. And it is an adventure because you don't know what the hell's going to happen. You truly don't. And what happens is, well, all sorts of strange things, like the demonstrations happen. But one of the things that's happened so far to me, which has been tremendously fortunate, is that people who regard themselves as their enemies array themselves against me. I'm trying to modulate my response like a reasonable person would, and then it reverses. Mm-hmm. So now I'm in this strange position. I've been laughing about this for about 6 months because it's so ironic. If I give a talk and it's canceled, well, then I get more publicity for it than if I give the talk.
That's the power of logos.
So, well, that's it. That's it. That's yeah. It. So it's so amusing. If, like, so what happened in Edmonton, in this little city in northern Alberta, I booked a theater there and was going to talk about my book, and they canceled it with no real explanation. They eventually apologized, but this was about 2 weeks ago. It was quite a scandal that this happened. They canceled it, and I was annoyed to begin with, especially because they kind of lied about how they canceled it. They pretended that I hadn't completed the paperwork and that I jumped the gun when I announced it. And that was, we hadn't signed the final bit of paperwork, but we'd been doing it for 3 weeks. I'd signed a bunch of paper. It was there completely in principle and in spirit. So they were really playing hard and fast with the truth. And that bothered me, the fact they lied about it, not the fact that they canceled the theater. But so they canceled the theater. It irritated the hell out of me. So I made public some of the paperwork. But what happened was someone emailed me like an hour later and said, look, I've got a venue you can have. It's bigger anyways. And then they offered me an even bigger venue. So now instead of talking to 200 people in Edmonton, I'm going to talk to 750 right. people. It's like, well,
that's showing you that the power of the satanic accuser is can be overcome by the power of logos, by nonviolent, you know, reason of not reciprocating with aggression, not extending evil.
I remember the other principle. Yes. Okay. So, but the thing is, the problem with the turn the other cheek thing or do not resist evil is that it's very difficult to discriminate it from weakness.
Right.
Right. Because I say I'm not resisting evil, but no, I'm just weak. It's a lie.
You don't
right?
cower. It's
yeah. That's
cowering.
Well, that's the thing. It's yeah. not cowering. So then one of the things I learned this year too, which was absolutely crucial, and I hope I've got this right, but I was fairly careful about it. I was looking at this line, the meek shall inherit the earth. And that line's always bothered me because meek sounds weak and cowardly. I thought, meek, the meek shall inherit the earth. So I was going through these biblical commentaries. There's a good site called Bible Hub. I love it because it has multiple translations of all of the verses and then all the commentaries. And you can look at one verse and there's like 3 pages of commentaries per verse. And so it's really instructive. And one of the things I learned was that either what meek meant when the translation was made has changed, or it was a mistranslation, because what it really means is something like, he who has a sword and knows how to use it but keeps it sheathed will inherit the world. I thought, oh yes, that's what that means. And so the resist not evil, the way that works out is set yourself up so that you could use overwhelming force if necessary.
But you don't.
But don't. Then use minimal force.
Right.
And that's perfect because then the response is proportionate.
Yeah.
It doesn't produce the kind of feuds that we talked about where things go out of hand exponentially.
Yeah.
You don't have to cower. And these reversals take place.
Yeah, you're breaking up the contagion of mimetic desire, the rivalry, right? Mm. Because what you're doing, instead of punching back, you're saying, go ahead, hit the other cheek.
Yeah.
You fulfilled the reciprocity within the double slap. Or, when it says in that same passage, when someone tells you to walk, the Roman soldier tell you to carry their load for a mile, do it 2 miles.
Right.
It's like Hulk Hogan. You're hulking up. You're like, mm-hmm. it's not going to hurt me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm dismantling your insult and turning it into an insult on you.
Mm-hmm.
Or when they take your cloak, give them your tunic too.
Right.
Well, if you're naked in the ancient world and you looked at someone's nakedness, you were shamed.
Mm-hmm.
So it reverses it. It's like mm-hmm. a comedic, satirical way of dismantling evil in its own way. It's like Aikido. You mm-hmm. let the power of the strike fall on its mm-hmm. own way.
Right, right.
That's what you're doing.
Right, it is
every
like
time
Aikido.
You stand in front of the crowd and you don't reciprocate it. You don't give them what they want. They want you to be a monster.
Well, or
they
even maybe what, to, or maybe even yeah. what I want.
Right.
Because like if you're attacked, there's a massive part of you that would love to transform into ultimate predator and tear things apart with your teeth. That there's something about that that's very satisfying, especially if you could actually have the victory. Like if you come after me and I think, okay, I have a method of tearing you to shreds. There's a part of me that would find that extremely, what would you call?
Satisfying.
Yeah. Well, and self-aggrandizing as well, right? Because it's a testament to power, but it's not, and it's better than weakness, but it's not as good as it could be. What it's better to transmute it to the degree that that's
it's a
possible.
Transmutation, exactly. Because that's what when Peter says, let it not be said, Lord, that you're going to die on the cross. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan.
Mm-hmm.
Get behind me, accuser. That word, Satan, means accuser. Get behind me, accuser. You know not the things of man. I mean, you know not the things of God, but the things of man. And that's what he's saying. Don't accuse me of being like you, Peter. I'm not here to have a William Wallace revolt. That's what Peter was thinking. He's like, you're feeding all these poor. You've got the movements. You've got the crowds. Don't tell me you're going to let them kill you.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, no, you don't get it, right? That's not going to solve this. We've got to break this. There's an evil power bigger than this, and it's not going to be solved by me doing a William Wallace revolt like Robin Hood.
Mm-hmm.
So don't accuse me of what you want, Peter.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe Peter's jealous of Jesus. There's mm-hmm. there's a sense in which he's trying to latch him into that magnetic attraction of rivalry. And he's like, I'm not going to let it go. And he mm-hmm. disengages. And that's mm-hmm. what you're talking about.
Yeah, well, you see kind of a weird echo of that in the scene where a woman comes up and breaks a vial of perfume over Christ's head. And then the disciples go after her because it's very expensive and that could have been used to feed the poor. You think, well, and that's kind of the social revolutionary idea too. If you have money, well, you should be using it to feed the poor. And Christ says the poor will always be with us, which is also something that's very much worth thinking about. And for about like a year, what that means. He's not taking the easy social revolutionary way out. I'm on the side of the oppressed. It's like, and we need to provide all the money that there is to elevate the poor. That was not a long-term solution. It's something like that.
And that's ultimately violence-based. That's sacrificial, accusatory way of doing poor, charity. Because if you're using welfare, you're saying violence makes right, and I'm going to force you at the barrel of a gun to make you more charitable. That's a shortcut to heaven that leads to hell.
Yeah, well, so that I suppose that's what's happening with the idea that of equality of outcome.
Right.
It's something like that.
Yeah. Well, very good. It's been a pleasure to speak with you. And 12 Rules for Life, An Antidote for Chaos. Any closing thoughts on the book or anything about where you're at right now with this whole experience?
Any closing thoughts on the book? Well, I hope that people... It's a justification for being good. That's what it is. And it's not a command to be good, which is, that's kind of what you do if you're a tyrant, as you say, meaning benevolent tyrant. Be good or else. It's like, no. It's an explanation for why there isn't anything more practical or useful or desirable than you could possibly take on, or let's say noble, than to be good. It's a description of why that's the case, an explanation instead of just a set of rules. It's funny because it's 12 rules, but that's not really what it is. It's not 12 rules. It's a description of why it's better to aim at the best that you can conceive of and live your life doing what's necessary to make that a reality. And I'm hoping it's compelling.
I think the gospel story, with telling the truthful account of what happened to Jesus and all of its gritty realism, and the fact that it's not the gods demanding it, but it's the crowd, I think you're harnessing that in your book and in your lectures. What I call the technology of the gospel gives you new eyes, because if you have the media, the gospel writers wrote it, but you have video and everything that we use now. Just show the story. Tell the story and undress the mob. Undress the unthinking crowd silliness and the sadness, the know not what they do that Jesus saw. And you just show it. Just tell the story. And in that sense, you're imitating the gospel technology itself. You know, where the writers are uncovering eyewitness account, and it dismantles the power of not knowing what you're doing. Because once you see it, once you have that mirror, you're like, why did she rail at this guy, you know, and just kind of belittle him and not treat him as a human being? And that's why 3 million people are saying, wait a second.
What the hell's going on?
Yeah, something's breaking through.
It's really interesting.
I think Jesus is in the driver's seat of history, and it's just great to see that you're in the middle of that, and many others, I hope, are going to help kind of come up, and that we can really turn this thing into a more positive direction.
That would be good, man. That would be good.
Because I'm a long-term optimist. I don't know about you, but I think in the long term...
Yeah, well, that's what I think, too. I think that we can do anything. We're in a position right now where we can do anything we want, so why don't we want the best thing and see if we can aim for that? That would be good. And I'm hoping that all these young guys and women that are putting themselves together, because there's lots of them, they're the beginning of the bottom-up attempt to make things better. That would be lovely, and I think it's possible. So that'd be better than descent into chaos on the right or the left, which is the alternative. So let's not do that. We did that a bunch already. That was the whole 20th century. Enough is enough, as far as I'm concerned. That's enough. We already went there. We don't have to go there again.
So love of your neighbor is the antidote for chaos.
It's the love of your neighbor. That's it. That's the equation. It's that you can have your cake and eat it too. That's the thing, is you can do what's best for you and do what's best for your neighbor simultaneously. And that would be a really good solution. So, and I think it's a possible, I think it is the solution, is to do that. So I don't think it's a pipe dream. Quite the contrary. I think it's the hardest thing you can do, and also the most worthwhile.
Ooh, baby, do you know that's
no problem. Good talking with you.
They say